number 1 point. Oil throttle. India has a very strategic position in the global oil flow. East Asia's oil passes through India. At the start of any major war, India could throttle China's oil supplies and merchandise exports. India could also use its ally Iran at the head of Hormuz and Southeast Asian allies around Malacca to further the blockade. Involvement of other powers. China's rise is not in any major power's interest. From US, UK, Germany to Russia, Japan and Korea are all scared of China's rise. For other Asian nations from Vietnam to Malaysia, a Chinese hegemony is a scary economic prospect. Although no one will directly involve, everyone will covertly provide aid to India. Internal destabilization. Right now India is not involved in China's autonomous regions, Inner Mongolia, Xinjiang and Tibet. But, if push comes to the shove, India has the powers to foment trouble given a huge domestic Muslim and Buddhist population. India could also use its traditional links with Mongolia, Taiwan, Vietnam, Japan to encircle China in a covert war. Chinese society is precariously balanced, especially when it comes to the non-Han minority, and given all the economic tensions in the fast-growing nation, it is easy to set the cat among the pigeons. In the same way, China could also do it in India, although with a little less success. Nuclear factor. While Pakistan has less to worry about India's nukes, nothing much to lose, China has everything to lose in a nuclear war with India. A cornered nation with nuclear power is the worst enemy you could have. Between China and India there is this huge great wall, called the Himalayas, which makes PLA's 4,000 plus tanks pretty much useless. In fact, in altitudes of 14,000 plus feet, which is where most of the war will be fought, its 100 plus attack helicopters won't be of much use either. The PLA will of course have a 1-3 advantage in artillery, and with a nice logistics line running right up to the border they can get the big guns in numbers and fast. So the Himalayan war will be restricted to infantry and artillery, where PLA has a 1-3 advantage. However, this advantage is dented because for being an overwhelming conventional force, a superiority of 1-6 is desired, more so in mountain warfare. Discounting support from the Air Force, which we will dig into later, PLA will be hard-pressed for sustaining offensive operations in India. In 1962, when Indian military was the weakest, the PLA could not extend beyond Dewang in eastern India as it stretched their logistics line too thin. Even though PLA is better now, the Indian Army has improved much more than 1962, and sustaining deep operations in the Indian theatre is not a tactical proposition for the PLA anymore. In the plain desert of western India, Pakistan's 1,900 plus tanks will be met by India's 3,000 plus tanks and its 0.5 million troop army by units of the Indian Army backed by the paramilitary BSF, with estimated 300,000 troops meant for the Pakistan border only. Regarding the Navy, though China may have a decent blue water capability, it does not have the numbers or the experience to sustain operations in the backyard of the Indian Navy, the second largest navy in Asia. Indian Navy's two carrier battle groups will pose a serious offensive threat to the surface fleet of both the Pakistan and Chinese navies. That brings us to the role of air forces, where PLAF has a distinct advantage, at least on paper. With 3,000 plus combat aircraft supported by Madeira refuelers, the PLAF is a force to contend with. However, apart from 250 plus Su-30 MKKs, 200 plus Su-27s and 200s plus JF-17s, rest of these aircraft are vintage Chinese variants of MiG-19 and MiG-21s. In the context of Sino-Indian conflict, China has primarily 6 airbases to launch strike aircraft from. However, all of these have altitudes in excess of 4,000 feet, which means the strike aircraft taking off will be carrying lesser payload. A PLAF Su-30 MKK, for example, will take off with 6 AIM missiles rather than 8. All EF airbases bordering China, primarily those in Bali, Tezpur, Hindon and Baghdad drew all at near sea level, allowing Indian Su-30 Mk to take off at full payload. IAF has reserved most of the 150-plus modern Su-30 Mk, a more lethal aircraft than Su-30 MKK due to superior radar and electronics, for the Sino border, while 300-plus modernized MiG-21, MiG-27s, MiG-29 and Jaguars can take care of the PAF. In addition, the IAF has 50-plus Mirage 2000 fighter aircraft which have superb ground combat and electronic capabilities, and these may be used for the Sino border too. On top of this, the IAF has a force multiplier than neither PAF or PLAF have, that is a WAX. Apart from Israel, IAF is the only Asian air force with Falcon AWACS mounted in IL-76 platforms. This gives IAF the capability to look 1,500 kilometers deep inside Chinese and Pakistan territories while flying in safe Indian airspace. All three countries have ballistic missiles, and each one can hit every corner of each other with nuclear weapons. So this will probably be the last resort. The Indian Research Arm for Ballistic Missiles has consistently demonstrated the accuracy of its anti-ballistic missile system, where in three trials it has demonstrated critical success. What is even more remarkable, that inbound missiles were also hit in exo-atmosphere, a capability known only with the US. Of course, what helps the Indian is the Green Pine radar that US and Israel shipped to India in a low-key event. If the anti-ballistic missile system does work, rendering Chinese and Pakistani ballistic missiles useless, it gives India an edge that the attacking neighboring can't match. Note, PLA only has a demonstrated capability to blow satellites, which was widely publicized. However, satellites have a known trajectory, and it is relatively very simple to blow them up without using sophisticated radars. Thus, a Pakistan-China axis will never really work against India.